This is John from Polymath Producer, and on this channel we analyze the great producers of all time, and we do that by reading their songs like a book. And when you read songs like a book, you really understand what the producer is doing, why they do things, and then how they think about the craft, so their decision-making process. Because if you understand the fundamental skill sets as to why they do things, you can understand their decision-making process. And then when you have that, then when you go to do the craft, when you go to create tracks, then your mindset starts to change, it starts to shift, and you start to think like the masters of the craft that you've been analyzing. And when you cross-pollinate all the different skill sets you're using and use them in your own way, that's when you can start to create stuff that you are truly proud of. So this week we're going to be looking at Greg Kurstin, one of the great pop producers of this era, and we're going to be looking at Chandelier by Sia. Now before we do that, spots have opened for the Polymath Producer System. I teach you how to read songs like a book so you can get any idea inside your head onto the DAW with ease and never be stuck again. Okay, you always have a world-class solution to any problem you face. So if you want to learn how to do that, go to polymathproducer.com and book a call with me. So I've got the studio here and I'm going to take you through track by track exactly what Greg did in this track, how he was thinking about the craft, why he did what he did. But before I do that, I want to note that this track was very different to a lot of the tracks that I've already analyzed in the 2010s era. So I wrote down some primary points that I wanted to say before I get into the instrumentation. The first thing was that I noticed this track in particular didn't necessarily have a secondary instrumental hook that really went through the whole track that was prominent. And I think the reason why is because this track is such a vocal centric song. Like, it's all about the vocal. And if they had a melodic kind of hook in the instrumental, it may have overpowered that. So they've opted for more of an arpeggiation as the secondary instrumental section. So you'll find that when I get into the instrumentation, that for the most part, the accompaniment material is mostly arpeggiated notes. So it's not necessarily hooky material. So the second point is about energetic development. What I notice about a lot of tracks in the 2010s is that the high-end percussion is usually one of the main things they use for energetic development over time. So they just add more and more high-end percussion until the finale, and then it's just like all this high-end percussion. Whereas in this track, they have energetic development between the sections. So you've got verse, pre-chorus, chorus, post-chorus, and they've got very clear energetic development there. It can be quite subtle, but you can it's clearly noticeable, which we'll get into when I go through the tracks. But what I notice is that it's basically the same energetic development for both parts. So you go verse, pre-chorus, chorus, post-chorus, and then there's an energetic development that goes like this, and then it repeats again. They didn't necessarily add extra energetic elements in the second time over, which we'll get into in here. And that's something that's very different to what a lot of the other tracks in the 2010s did, because they a lot of the time had those energetic developments that were more, they had more layers added over time. Now I talk about advanced arrangement subtleties a lot in this channel, and they're basically little things that world-class producers do that are seemingly random. Like, to the average person, that'd seem like random elements. Like, for example, in the Ian Kirkpatrick stuff, there's just always like these weird little voice things in the background. There's like, it just sort of seems like that he just throws random stuff in there and it makes no sense, but it adds character to the track and it really makes it like separates the world-class producers from the rest of the guys. In this track, advanced arrangement subtleties were used very well, okay? And we'll get into that soon. But it's almost like, yeah, this is the thing that really separates the world-class people from the rest, is like this use of advanced arrangement subtleties. It's not just this. This is just one of the things that separates them, but it's something that a lot of them do that a lot of other people don't do. So we'll get into that deeply in this analysis. Another thing I noticed is that the core harmonic rhythmic driver in this track is outlined in the verse. So it's outlined with the arpeggiated material. And if you don't know what the core harmonic rhythmic driver is, it's basically the main harmonic rhythmic material that's usually in the mid-level range that runs through the whole track. What I noticed about this track was that there's a core harmonic rhythmic driver that outlines the core rhythm in the verse, and then the drums in the chorus play the same rhythm as the harmonic rhythmic driver in the verse, but they take over that rhythm in the chorus, and then that actually doesn't carry over. The harmonic material actually goes sustained at that point, which I'll get into and straight rhythm, which I'll get into in there as well. So that was something different between this track and other 2010s tracks as well. Usually in the 2010s tracks, the core harmonic rhythmic driver will flow with the drums in that way. So it was quite an odd thing to see. Their use of effects in this was also very strange. There's an effects section, but it's very quiet and in the background, And there's a lot of strategic, like advanced arrangement subtleties used, but it's very quiet in the background, which we'll get into in here as well. The last thing I wanted to note before I start is that their use of instruments is also quite strange in this, in terms of the sound of each individual instrument. Another thing with world-class producers is that they use not only one instrument that's different. A lot of producers, when they start out, think they have to just get one instrument that sounds very unique, which you can do. But what I noticed with the world-class producers is that they try to make every instrument sound unique if they can. So what I noticed in this track was that all the different elements that he's used all sound unique, okay? And there's a very unique sonic identity to the track, and that's another reason why it stands out so much. So we're gonna go deep into that as well. So we're gonna be looking at the guitars first off, and the way they've used the guitars is actually a very old school way, which is using the guitar and repurposing it in multiple different ways, but layering them in different ways. So in this track, they've used the guitars only in the chorus and the post-chorus, and the guitars have multiple purposes. One, the mid-level material, it has power chords on every chord change, so that really just outlines the harmonic movement of the track, plus has the main hit on the beat one, which we've noticed in a lot of tracks, especially in the 2010s, is they emphasize that beat one. The other thing it does is it outlines the core harmonic rhythmic driver really, and that's in the arpeggiated notes. So it's like a two-note arpeggiation. I'd say that that's the secondary instrumental hook that I was talking about earlier on in the video, but it's not necessarily hooky in terms of like it'll get stuck in your head. It's more of like they've opted for that arpeggio rather than a more catchy hook, because the song is so catchy in itself and so vocal centric, that's probably why they've done that. So here is what the guitar sounds like, and this is at the entrance of the chorus. So chords on the start, chords on every change. 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. It's like a power chord. And it almost sounds like it might have maybe multiple chords. So it has like a lower chord plane with a higher chord plane on it as well. So they're just covering more of that frequency spectrum. I don't know if that's the case, but that's what it sounds like. And they've also got the arpeggiations. Have a listen. And the arpeggio has a lot of reverb on it. It was very ethereal. And that basically stays the same for the entire track, for the chorus and the post-chorus. Here's what it sounds like with the rest of the track. Very straight, contrasting with the very syncopated drum kit. Now the cool thing about this guitar is that it actually doubles the piano that's doing basically the same thing. Have a listen. So that's the piano. That's the guitar. So they're basically doing the same thing, but they're just doubled with each other. The piano, however, I believe is an octave higher in the arpeggiation. And it may even be an octave lower on its low end. So the piano is playing like a big octave hit on the root note chords. And I believe that it's actually an octave lower than the guitar as well. So the main guitar power chords, I think it's an octave lower than that. So the guitar is fitting very nicely in between the piano. So the piano is essentially hugging the guitar, but they're playing basically the same thing, which I think is very cool. Just octaves apart. So the whole frequency spectrum is covered. Now, I believe that the piano is a real piano. I think it is. It's very hard to know, but I'd say it is real because it's got a lot of depth and power to it, quite reverb heavy as well, especially on the top end. Now the piano only plays on the chorus and the post-chorus, exactly the same as the guitars. So they're really reserved for that section only. And ultimately I believe that's the core harmonic rhythmic driver, so it's the main harmonic material that's driving the song. And it's odd because it actually counteracts with the drums, so the core rhythm of the song is actually different. It flows well with the bass, because the bass is actually straight. Bass is a straight rhythm. That's the bass. So when it flows with that, it's actually smooth, it's sustained with the arpeggio, so it's very straight. But the drums, if you listen to the drums by themselves, they're very syncopated. There's a lot of offbeat notes. The hats are very straight. So the hats are really the only thing that's straight enough to really flow with that. So that's the one of the first tracks that I've found where the core harmonic rhythmic driver actually counteracts with what the drums are doing. So that's a very important thing to note, is that there are no rules, really. Ultimately, there are no rules. There's just things that tends to be things that work a lot of the time. So the bass is actually multiple basses in one. Basically, in the history of recorded music, there's always tracks with multiple basses in them. And it tends to be getting a lot more prevalent in the 2010s and onwards. So if you look at songs in the 80s, they sometimes have like a real bass laid with a synth bass. And now it seems to be a very common thing. So in this track, there is like three basses laid as one. I think the only track we've seen with like four basses was Bang Bang with Max Martin, but this particular track has three basses. So in the chorus, I'm pretty sure it's three. In the chorus, have a listen to the bass. So it sounds like, you've got like a lower level bass, a top end bass, and then one that's more like attack hit on the entrance of the changes. Because in the verses, you've got like a bass hit on the one, which actually hits as more of an effects thing. Because if you have a listen to the track, it hits right there on one of the song. So you've got like a little fill for the intro, and then it just goes doom and hits on the one, and then it fades out. And there's a sub drop, very subtle sub drop, and then hits again on the one. So he's just sort of teasing the bass in the verse. Sub drop again. Bass starts to come in a lot more. So he was really just using more sub level, like very low end. And then in the pre-chorus, he introduces more of like a mid-range bass. And it's just a pad, really. And I believe, And then he kind of cuts off the low end and then has just the mid level, and then it goes and fades out in like an effects way. But when this hits, it sounds like the pre-chorus bass, but then he's got like a top level bass, or he's filtered it off so that like the top end shows. I'm not actually sure, but it sounds like multiple basses in one. And that plays basically the same for the whole chorus. It's just a sustained root note. There's no like real passing notes or anything. So what I noticed was that in the post-chorus, they actually add an extra bass that flows with the core rhythm now, because they've had the bass, they've had the core harmonic rhythmic driver mostly sustained, and the drums, the core rhythm of the drums is doing something different. But in the post-chorus, they add a more pulsating bass and an extra bass that plays along with the core rhythm. Have a listen to this. If you can hear that, it's very subtle. And that is actually flowing with the drums. Accentuating the core rhythm that's basically the bass. It's actually quite simple. It really just moves from in the verse to a, from a simple like sub bass type thing. He's got the sub drops, which are used as a stylistic thing. Then he's got like more of a, I guess, a Reese bass type thing in the pre-chorus that's just sustained, very mid-level type. And then he's opened it up completely in the chorus. So energetic development-wise, he started off with mainly the lower end frequencies, and then as the track develops and opens up, he goes more mid, and then finally in the chorus, full highs and full lows all stuck together. And then in the post-chorus, adds more of a rhythmic element with the sustained one. So that's the energetic development that's happened. And he's done that both with frequency spectrum and rhythmically. What you'll notice, I'll touch on this again, is that in a lot of tracks, especially modern tracks, the tracks start with more of like a centralized frequency spectrum. So it's more like mid-range type, like, or sometimes low end as well. And then as the track progresses, it gets wider and wider in frequency width as the energy progresses, because energy is, I suppose, most intense on the very low end, because you can feel it. Like when they're sub, you can actually feel it, like it rattles your stomach type stuff, and then it vibrates. And then the top end frequencies are very harsh, so that adds more energy that way. So if you just start off in the mid and then you move up like this and widen it out, then that's kind of like the energetic flow that you have. And this happens not only on a macro level, but on micro level as well. So in terms of inside the bars, it happens as well, most notably with percussion and drum elements, because they're hitting on a static position a lot of the time, whereas the sustained instruments are kind of just staying the same. So this is the kind of stuff you need to think about. And ultimately, this is what I talk about with Polymath Producer, is that when you're a technical producer, so you're more inside the DAW, a lot of the times you miss the macro level stuff like this. Like when you're a big picture producer, you have this mindset of like, how's the energetic development over time? And when you have both mindsets, that's when you become a polymath producer. You can actually sit back, look at the big picture, and then zoom in and do what you need to do as well. So in the post chorus, there's actually a very subtle pad that plays as well, that's sustained. Mid-level, mid to high. So you're probably thinking, why have they put a pad in the post-chorus section and it's very subtle and you can barely hear it? Well, the way that I sort of view pads is that they're like glue. So they glue sections together, and they also can develop the track in a very subtle way energetically without the audience actually even knowing. So in this case, the pad is filling out more of the mid to high frequencies in a way that's very subtle. It expands the energy of the track. So if you listen to it with the full thing, and I believe it's actually playing an octave lower melodically, because it's got like a bit of a top melody. It's playing melodically the same as what the strings are doing. So if you have listened to the strings, it's kind of accompanying them. Not playing the exact same thing, but it's flowing with that. It really just adds a little something to the post chorus. And these are the type of things that I was trying to mention before with these world-class producers. They tend to add these very subtle things to develop energy without the audience even knowing. So they've got their foreground material, the stuff that the audience is actually hearing, which is like the drums, the vocal, in this case, the string element as well, which I'll get to in a second, but they're hearing particular things. And in the background though, very subtle things to fill out space, fill out energy development. So there are strings in this track. Again, these only come in the chorus and post-chorus. And sure enough, they're actually doubling the guitar and piano as well. So the way that I sort of view this effect is kind of in a Hans Zimmer way. If you listen to a lot of Hans Zimmer stuff, and if you don't know who Hans Zimmer is, he's a film score composer. So he actually uses in a lot of his film scores one motive that repeats And then as energy progresses, he actually layers that same secondary instrumental melody with multiple different instruments and in different octaves, different ways, but it's always the same motive and it's just repeated over and over again. And then it just develops over time. He's like a master at just having the same motive repeat over and over again, but makes the whole track sound interesting because he develops energy around it. It's kind of like an orchestration move. And in this track, they've used guitars with the motive. So if they've got the sustained, then they've got the arpeggio. And then with the piano, they've got the sustained in the low end again, and arpeggio in the high end, exactly the same as the guitar. But as I said earlier, the piano kind of hugs the guitar. And then the strings are doing the exact same thing. So they've got the pizzicato strings, which are like the pluck strings at the very top, which are doing the arpeggio. And they've got sustained strings on an octave. So I think it's like maybe a cello doing one octave, then they've got like violas doing another octave. And then as the track progresses, you can hear, they actually add violins an octave even higher. So I think it's the second half of the chorus. So they've just got low end sustained strings here. And then in the second half of the chorus, another one comes in. So subtle energy play with what you've got. Key. In the post-chorus, now, I thought this was really cool what they've done here. So in the post-chorus, they've used the repurposing principle. They've grabbed the lead vocal melody line, and then they've repurposed it as an instrumental in the strings underneath the post-chorus. So the vocal isn't doing that melody anymore. It's doing a different vocal melody, but they're still playing the lead vocal melody. Have a listen. They swing from the chandelier. They make a variation of it though. They don't do exactly the same, but they've got the I'm gonna swing from a chandelier. Like, it's the same, basically. But they've just made variations on it. Yeah, I thought that was a very cool way of using the repurposing principle, is to like grab the lead vocal melody and then repurpose it underneath the vocal while the vocal's doing something different. And then when it does the lead melody, you change the melody again underneath. So it's more of a secondary accompaniment material at that point. Now, as that's playing the lead melody, they've got the arpeggiated strings still playing, but they're an octave lower, I think. Oh no, it's the same. Yeah, same octave. It sounds more staccato though, rather than pizzicato in this section. I guess the principle that you want to understand here is, number one, using like the Hans Zimmer approach of stacking multiple layers of multiple different textures is an orchestral move. Okay, it's really an orchestral move. He's got this sustained in the low end and the mids, with the strings, the piano, and the guitars, and they're all covering a wide range. And then he's got the arpeggiated more in the mid to high end, and he's covering all of that range with the strings, guitar, and piano as well. And they're all hugging each other. They're all hugging the vocal as well. And this is ultimately the core harmonic rhythmic driver, which also flows with the bass. So as you can see, it's a wall of sound. It's literally a wall of sound. I've listened to all of those together. It's just this boom, wall of sound. It covers everything. Genius stuff. Moves higher for energetic intensity right when the post-chorus is about to end. Most of those elements that we looked at so far actually only happen in the chorus and the post-chorus. Except for the bass, which plays the sub bass and the kind of re bass in the pre-chorus. There's another element in the chorus that only comes in the second half of the chorus, which is this one. Very strange. The Ian Kirkpatrick one we looked at, there was a weird sort of rhythmic element that he put in the background that kind of didn't make any sense, but it had rhythmic flow. And then in the Max Martin one, The Hands to Myself, he also had a similar thing there. And I think this is almost like a variation on that. It's a little bit more harmonically out there, but it's still got that weird rhythmic movement, and it's subtle enough that it's in the background that you wouldn't know it was there unless you isolated it. So it's definitely a hidden element, but it's quite weird. Like, it only comes in the second half of the chorus for both times that the chorus plays, and then that's it. It doesn't happen any other time, but it's got a very weird rhythmic movement to it. So I think the reason why they've put that in there is really, for one, for the more energy development in the second half of the chorus, just in a very subtle way, just differentiating the second half of the chorus with the first bit of the chorus, and also adding that like bit of rhythmic movement as well. So I think that's kind of why it works, is because it's got like the high end, mid to high end frequencies, plus the rhythmic material that sort of emphasizes a counter rhythm kind of thing. But again, these are the kind of subtle things that these world-class producers do that a lot of other producers don't make decisions with. So that's mainly all the instruments that happen in the chorus in terms of like, in terms of the core harmonic rhythmic driver kind of stuff. We'll move on to the verse now, because that's where the synth section starts. So have a listen to this section. Party girls, don't get hurt, can't feel anything. When we're like... This is the section we're looking at. Okay, firstly, before we move on, what I want to note about this, because that was verse one, and the same thing happens in verse two with this instrument, and it is like a bell type synth. And it's really the core harmonic rhythmic driver of this section. And the cool thing about it is that it actually is playing the same rhythm as the drum rhythm in the chorus, but in the verse, in an instrumental way. So they've repurposed the core rhythm for the verse. So if you have listened to the drums isolated in the chorus, now listen to the synth in the verse. It's the same rhythm as the drums in the chorus. So I thought that was really cool. They're using the repurposing principle to grab the core rhythm and use it in the verse, but without any drums. Because the drums in this are kind of very minimalistic. Like, they've got the little fill at the start, sort of start the song. And all it is just this little snare and like some snaps. That's all it is. So they've got the snaps on the two and the four, and a snare doing kind of like a build snare thing. So the core rhythm is actually getting played by the synth, even though the drums are present, which I thought was cool. They've sort of flipped it back around, and then they flip it around in the chorus. And then what's interesting there is then when the drums come in and take over the core rhythm, they change the rhythm of the synth to be more straight, which is exactly what they do in the chorus as well. And it does arpeggios, which is more in line with what happens in the chorus as well. So it's a straight arpeggio rhythm down the bottom, and then if you can hear that top synth as well, comes in as well, and that's more of like a counter rhythm synth. It's like doom, da, 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 da. So it's more of a glitchy type. It's like a counter melody slash counter rhythm with the vocal. Have a listen very carefully. what it's kind of doing is it's almost a counter melody, like almost like a harmony to the vocal, because the vocal is going 1 2 3 1 2 3 drink, and this the synth melody is going like 1 2 drink, and it's stopping at the same time as the vocal. So it's almost like a counter melody / counter rhythm at the same time with the vocal. 1 2 3 1 2 3 drink 1 2 3 1 2 3 drink 1 2 3 1. It's almost like a call and response thing, but like at the same time, it's like very interesting. 1 2 3 drink. In this instrument, there's also a lot of like effects and things like that. So I'll quickly go through some of the effects that are in this. You've got a reverse vocal just before the pre-chorus. Then it starts. So that would be for the vocal here. So it's just in between. So these very subtle things is another thing that world-class producers do, is they put these very subtle like reverse elements in, things like that, just to add that real like world-class sound. So right there, they had a white noise rise. And then another one comes that's even louder. And then they've got this big like pre-chorus hit that goes doo, like that, hits hard. So when the chorus hits, the bell is doing a hit on every beat. Have a listen. So the bell has actually gone from being syncopated doing the core harmonic rhythmic driver in the verse to doing arpeggio straight in the pre-chorus, and now it's doing a straight like pulse hit on every beat of the song. So it's in line with that straight rhythm. And that happens in the chorus, and that continues all the way through the post-chorus as well. But what I really think is odd about this section is that they add entrance hits of every chord using this like brass hit almost. Have a listen. I don't even know if you can hear that. And it's very delayed as well, very distorted, hits on every chord change, and it's covering like a huge frequency spectrum, and then it starts to hit on every beat, like every like eighth note. You hear that? That's in the post-chorus now. So this element is so subtle as well. Like I made it louder so you can actually hear it. But without it, like without with all the other instruments, you can't even hear it. Have a listen to it with the rest of the arrangement. You wouldn't even know it's there. Wait till it gets. It's on every eighth note, and then ready. Where'd it go? Where'd it go? Don't even know it's there. And it's got a very harsh attack on it as well. Like it's really hitting that eighth note, and you don't even know it's there. It's crazy stuff. So I really wanted to point that out because that's what I'm talking about here. Like what I tend to keep seeing is that these world-class producers are layering just that little bit extra. So it's like these subtle elements that you don't even know exist. So I thought that was very cool. So I kind of want to cover the foreground background principle in this track, because the foreground background principle is basically what instruments are in the foreground at any given time and what instruments are more in the background, or you know, the middle at any given time. And in this track, it's quite interesting to see how they've used this principle, because the vocal is always in the foreground. It's like the most vocal centric song ever. And that's really the primary hook of the track, because you can really look at tracks as three different hook levels. Like you've got your primary, which is in the foreground at any given time, and you've got your secondaries, which you can still hear, but they're not necessarily in the foreground all the time. And then you've got your hidden hooks, and those are the ones that are basically, you don't even know they're there until you isolate them. So in this track, the primary is definitely the vocal. It's a very vocal centric track. In the secondary, you've got the drums, which are probably the second most heard thing in this track. Like, they're very foreground. Then you've got the bass, which is like massive. That's very foreground. Then you've got the piano, probably, and the background vocals. You've got the synths in the verse, which is playing the core harmonic rhythmic driver. And then you've got the strings in the post chorus, which tend to come through as a secondary instrumental hook, which plays the lead hook in an instrumental way as the vocalist singing their own hook. So it's quite interesting, that section. But in the hidden hooks, you've really got like strings for the most part are hidden, because you don't even really know they're there, because they're layered with the guitar and the piano. You've got like those pluck things that happen midway through the chorus, which were like for rhythmic, to accentuate the rhythm. It was very weird. That's hidden. You've got the synths in the chorus and those effects things that I just mentioned before, which are completely hidden. You don't even know they're there unless you isolated them. You've got reverbs and delays, which are very prominent in this track as well. And then you've got particular guitars that are also hidden as well, like the guitar hits power chords. So have a listen to the track. The chorus, vocal, drums, bass, piano, and then the rest you can't even really hear. That's it. Everything else is disguised. If you were the average listener, you wouldn't. All you'd be focusing on is the vocal, the drums, and the bass. That's it. And maybe the piano you could hear on the top. In this section, though, you'll be able to hear the strings. Comes in. So I really just wanted to point that out. They've used the foreground background principle very well in this track. So the drums sound. The drums start very basic. It's just the snaps and the little snare hit. There's also like some weird popping sound. I don't know what that is. Probably an advanced arrangement subtlety. Now, have a listen to this. They started to use macro level energy development with the drums. So they've got very quite dry stuff in the verses, very dry, and then they use effects form to develop the track. So in the pre-chorus, adding a kick, they've got cymbal hits, and they've got a big reverb snare clap on the fourth beat, which is something that we've noticed a lot in these modern tracks, is that they tend to emphasize particular beats. Have a listen. On the fourth. So what's playing at that point? On the drink. Just a straight hi-hat hit. And the kick is a lot less powerful in the pre-chorus. It's got the same rhythm, but it's more just like the low end and mid. And then in the chorus, they've got like the full kick stack. Have a listen. Way bigger. So they've just really layered the kick in the chorus to really hit hard. They've got a lot more top end in the chorus as well. Now the drums actually stay quite consistent throughout the whole track in terms of energetic development. As I mentioned at the start of this video, they don't tend to add more high-end percussion over time like a lot of the other modern tracks do. They actually just repeat the same thing twice. So the verse and the chorus and the post-chorus essentially repeat the same thing in the second time they go around. So this plays basically the same thing. They've got multi-layered kick. They've got a big clap snare thing, probably layered multiple times. They've got a closed hat that's playing a nice straight rhythm at the top. They've got a tom, like a snare tom fill, that plays a particular pattern on every chord progression turnaround. So as the chord progression changes, as the chord progression finishes, they play the same fill over and over again. Similar to like the Be My Baby effect. Like in Be My Baby, they've got that very distinctive snare fill, that doom 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 ch-ch-ch, doom 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 ch-ch-ch. And every time I see or I notice a fill in a track that sort of repeats the same thing over and over again, it almost becomes a hook in itself. And it's kind of like the Be My Baby effect. Like the snare is a hook in that song. The fill is a hook in this track. The only time they change it is just before the post-chorus, where they're kind of making a statement there. They change the fill. They're like, okay, this is going to change now. Like, this is about to change into a different section. The only thing that changes in the chorus is halfway through the chorus, on the second half of the chorus, there's more of a eighth note mid-level hit. If you can hear that. Adds more movement. It's quicker paced. It's on an eighth note. So it's flowing with that hi-hat hit. Again, very subtle. Like they've opted for very subtle energetic developments. This is more in the mid-range. So rather than adding more high-end percussion, they've added more mid-range movement. Different feel. Crash on the entrance. Crash on every bar, actually. In this section, this is the post-chorus. Different crashes for different sections as well, like in terms of intensity of crashes. So the principles you want to understand here is that in the verse, they started the percussion off very dry. Okay, that's number one. They've used effects form to develop energy in the track. So they've started off dry. As the pre-chorus started, they started to introduce more bigger claps. And then in the chorus, they've got the big sort of massive wet hits on the two and four. And they've got the tom hits, as the fills as well, and the crashes and all that. But if you look at the energetic development in terms of elements added, you've got dry, very minimal in the verse. Then you've got like started to progress in the pre-chorus, width of frequency spectrum starts to get wider. And in the chorus, that's the section where they've got the most layers on each individual hit. So the snare claps are the biggest. They've got a way more layered kick, which I'm pretty sure has toms laid with it as well, which are very reverbed. I'm not entirely sure, but I think it is. And then they've got like the consistent hi-hat. They've got the crashes at that point. They've got the extra percussion in the mid-level that happens as a subtle energetic move midway through the chorus. And then in the post-chorus, they've got way more crashes to kind of emphasize that. Yeah, I think it's pretty cool. Let's listen to it with the rest of the arrangement. So they've actually got an extra snare hit on the post-chorus as well. And I think that takes place on the fourth beat. Very subtle. So just that extra layer, just to add a little extra punch in the post-chorus, just to differentiate it from the chorus. The last thing I want to speak about in this track is the vocals. Now, in the backing vocals, they start in the pre-chorus. And it's really two different harmonies, so I'm pretty sure they've got a lower end harmony and a higher end harmony. If you listen to it with the lead vocal. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. So quite interesting harmonies. I thought the cool thing about this section, though, is the weird vocal glitch that they've got in the background. What? Like they've done like a vocal glitch. Again, very subtle moves. Like this, you don't even really know it's there until it's pointed out. Like have a listen to it with the rest of the track. And what I kind of like about this is it's kind of similar to the Ian Kirkpatrick approach in a pre-chorus, where if you noticed in, I think it was New Rules, the one that we analyzed with Ian Kirkpatrick, he added a lot of chaotic elements in the pre-chorus during the build, just before the chorus hits. And then there's like a loop disruption just before the chorus, exactly the same as this track, like where there's a loop disruption. And in the pre-chorus build, so when you're building up intensity of energy, sometimes putting in chaotic elements like this one can add to that, because it's like a counter rhythm. And when you're adding energy, a lot of the time counter rhythms can help, but the world-class producers do it in a different way. So rather than just adding like random counter melodies, they tend to make very unique sounding sounds that are just unique to this track at hand. So in this case, they've used a very unique vocal, which is the singer, obviously, because that's why a lot of people use vocal glitches, because it's specific to the singer and no one else would be able to copy it unless they had the singer. So they have Sia here and they've just grabbed the vocal and kind of made it a glitch in the pre-chorus, made it a bit chaotic, and that kind of just adds to the vibe of the track in this section. Like the pre-chorus, it started to get a bit chaotic, which I thought was very cool. And I suppose it kind of vibes with the, actually flows with the lyrical context as well, because it's that this is when they're throwing back drinks. So it's almost like you're just losing your mind. Like you just have no clue what's going on. And I thought it was cool because it's actually quite a different counter rhythm to this synth that we looked at earlier. So you have the one, so you've got the lead vocal going 1 2 3 1 2 3 drink, which is straight, and then you've got the one that's going 1 1 1 like that counter, then you've got the other one that's going dan, 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 which is kind of following the lead vocal but doing something a bit weird as well. So you've got a little bit of chaos there, which I thought was very cool. The backing vocals as well in the chorus, in the entrance to the chorus, they're actually harmonizing that first word right here, harmonized, three-part harmony I believe, then they go just double and double octave lower, so double for width left and right, octave lower double left and right, just for the chorus. Covering frequency spectrum with both octaves. Feel my tears as I dry. I'm gonna swing from the chandelier, but I'm holding on for dear life. Won't look down, won't open my eyes. Keep my glass full until. Sounds like there's three part harmony here. I'm just holding on for tonight. Help me, I'm holding on for dear life. Won't look down. So it sounds like they've got like one higher, they've got one lower, and they've got the lead in the middle. Keep my glass full until morning light, cause I'm just holding on for tonight, on for tonight. So yeah, that's kind of what the background vocals are doing in this section as well. So they kind of move between doubles and like octave doubles, and they've got like three-part harmony as well. It kind of just moves depending on the section and what they're really looking for. So that's pretty much everything I wanted to look at with this track. I thought it was very cool, a lot of stuff they've done. It sounds very unique compared to a lot of the other tracks that we've looked at, that you have used similar like principles, but in different ways to everyone else. That's really what I'm trying to get at here, is that when you understand the fundamentals of the craft and you understand how these people, these world-class producers make decisions, then you can use them in your own way, okay? So we've got particular mindsets that we've learned from this track, especially ones to do with like subtlety and subtlety of energy development. And when you understand that, you can really come at your tracks in a different way to everyone else. And you can really step your game up to like that professional level. If you want to learn how to read songs like a book yourself, and you want to learn how to think like a master, like have the ideas in your head, those world-class solutions to every problem that you're facing, and effortlessly get them onto the DAW, then I highly recommend going to polymathproducer.com and booking a call with me. So hope to see you there, and until next time, I'll see you then.